Look around you. There's so much work to do. This world is in no condition for us to simply sit back and watch. There is a tangible, desperate need for Jesus. A glimpse of hope in the midst of hopelessness. Jesus experienced this. He saw it firsthand. The need broke his heart and filled him with compassion. He turned to his disciples and said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." This alone should stir our hearts. It's a calling. A calling to make a difference, to share the truth of the gospel, to be a light in the darkness, to be the church. It's time for us to look beyond ourselves, to turn our focus to the field, to answer the call and passionately share the love of Jesus. This is our mandate. This is our mission. Are you ready to do the work?
Well, good morning, Desert Hope. So great to see you all. You all look good today. Turn to the person next to you and say, "You're looking really good today." Now, if you had to fake that, look to the other person and say, "You're looking really fine today." There we go. Hey, if that's not an icebreaker, there we go. That works. Hey, good to see you guys. Welcome to those of you joining us online as well. We're so glad that you're tuning in, and we pray God has a word for you today. We are in a message series called A New Beginning, and God is doing something new in us. And week one, we really challenged ourselves by asking a challenging question that we're going to be looking at for the rest of this series, but that's the question that we want to look at again today is, what needs to end so that something new may begin? In week two, we said that moving forward is knowing that God's presence is with us. How many of us know today that we have to be reminded always that God is with us? Amen, church? Amen. He is with us. He is here. And I want you to believe that God is working in ways that we do not yet understand, but in time, in season, as God speaks, as God directs, as God leads us and guides us, we will understand. In week three, we said that if we were going to move into this future that God has for Desert Hope, we need a fresh touch from God. Like Elijah, he was depressed, he was discouraged, he was worn out. He needed a fresh touch from God, and that's what we looked at in week three. And that's exactly what we need as a church, a fresh touch from the Lord. And last week, if you were here, we said that God doesn't only move in the big things, right? He moves in the small things. God doesn't shout, God speaks with a whisper. In the Hebrew, that's literally translated a brief moment of silence. You know, some of the most powerful sermons that I've ever heard are the silent sermons of God. When God speaks in a whisper, when God speaks with a still, quiet voice, when our conscience is quickened and our ears hear the voice of God, not in a booming kind of way, but in a very quick moment of silence. And today, here's where we're heading. This is the big idea for today. God is not done with you yet. Say that with me. God is not done with you yet. He has more work for you to do. He has more people for you to bless. God has more disciples for you to make and more lives for you to touch. If you have ever thought for a moment, "God, I am done. I put my time in. I'm tired. I'm worn out." Today is the message for you. God is not done with you yet. He has great things in store for you, and the plans of God as they unfold for you in a new way, maybe even in ways in which you have never dreamt of before, God will receive the glory. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. You can also use your smart device if you have that. We have Bibles for you. If you do not own a Bible, simply take that with you, our gift to you. And as you're turning there in 1 Kings chapter 19, let me give you a brief reminder of where we were last week, because it's important to remember that Elijah was in a cave. He was depressed. He was discouraged. He was running away in a sense of not facing his fears. Jezebel was putting out threats and his life was threatened. And so he found himself in a cave, worrying for his life, fearing for his life. And God said, I want you to come out of that cave, Elijah. And I want you to stand on the mountain. And you know the story, right? A great and mighty, powerful wind came, but God was not in the wind, right? He came in an earthquake, and God wasn't in the earthquake. He came in a fire, and God was not in the fire. And then a still, small voice, a gentle whisper, a brief moment of silence. And then we pick it up with the same question now that God asks a second time. Let's look at it. This is verse 13b. Same question, verse 13b. Then a voice said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? God understands this principle, that a great question asked holds the potential for a life lesson to be discovered. When you ask the right questions, you lead a person into discovering something that they may not know at the moment, but as the Lord continues to work in his life, work in her life, the Lord will bring them to a place of discovering something that they could never discover on their own. Asking the right questions is so important. Good leaders learn how to ask great questions. You know, there's a great book by Frank Cessna. He's a former CNN political analyst and journalist. He wrote a book that's called Ask More, The Power of Questions to Open Doors, Uncover Solutions, and Spark Change. And the premise of this book is to unlock the door of opportunity for a person to see something they've never seen before. Asking the right questions will do that. They'll open the right door, which will lead to the right opportunity, which will lead to a lasting part in their life that's lasting change. Lasting change, and that's what we want. And Jesus is the mastermind at doing this. He's the mastermind of asking great questions, and he's the mastermind of telling great stories too. I love the story in Luke chapter 15 when Jesus is hanging out with some Pharisees and teachers of the law, and they're murmuring under their breath, well, Jesus here is, hanging out with these tax collectors and sinners and all the filthy ones, you know, and he's over here doing what the religious people don't do. And Jesus said, oh, yeah, let me tell you a story, boys. There was 100 sheep. Suppose one of y'all had 100 sheep and one of them went missing. Wouldn't you leave the 99 and go and search for the one? And when you find the one, you put it on your shoulder and you rejoice and you go home and you grab your friends and your family and you rejoice. And Jesus said to them, in the same way, there will be rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who don't need to repent. What a story! Or how about a great question? In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus asks a powerful question. He's now with his disciples, bud time, one-on-one. He says, all right, boys, what's the talk on the street? What are you hearing? Who do the people say that I am? And they say, well, you know, Jesus, some say that you're John the Baptist. Others say that you're Elijah, or others still say that you're Jeremiah, one of the prophets. And then Jesus turns it right directionally toward them. He said, all right, but how about you? Who do you say that I am? And Peter goes on to make that great confession. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. What a question! Jesus was the mastermind of asking great questions that led to absolute discovery. And Elijah found himself hearing for the second time a question from God. Have you ever been asked before by God the same question? Maybe 2 times, 3 times, 4 times? You know, there's a reason for that. Let's unfold it and let's look at Elijah's response the second time. This is verse 14. And it says, I have been very zealous. This is Elijah speaking. I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. Now notice that this is the same exact response that he gave in verse 10. Look at verse 10 in your Bibles. It's the same exact parallel word-for-word response that Elijah gave previously, because God is trying to change his point of view, his reference point. And you see, Elijah is stuck. Elijah's stuck. He can't move forward. There's no way to process the pain and the darkness and the fear and the anxiety and the worry in such a way that would lead him out of where he is. He is stuck. And you know, my wife loves it when I get stuck. The other day, she said something to me. She said, honey, you're getting a little hairy. Are you going to shave sometime soon? And she said hairy instead of hairy. And immediately, when I heard her say hairy, my mind went back to Oklahoma. That's not where it was. Not Oklahoma. Home Alone. Geez, where'd that come from? Yeah, close. Right, yeah. Home Alone 2, where Marv is getting pegged in the head with all those bricks. You know, there's Harry, and he's trying to dodge the bricks, and all of them hit Marv. And eventually Marv is like, Harry! Harry! Anyway, I could not get out of that the whole day. You want to see your pastor go crazy? That was me. I get stuck. And I couldn't stop saying all afternoon, Harry. And I was kind of making fun of her because she said Harry instead of Harry. You're kind of hairy. You're going to shave. But that's, you know, that's the truth. We get stuck. We all get stuck in some way or another. And Elijah is stuck here. Worry has taken over. Fear has set in. Depression is a reality that he is facing. He is stuck in himself. And you know what is amazing to me? Is one chapter earlier, in 1 Kings chapter 18, he has the confidence that God has given to him to stand up against 450 false prophets of Baal. And not only did he stand in the confidence of God, he led the people to repentance. One chapter later, he is stuck in a cave, in darkness, living in fear, running for his life. Don't ever think that you're exempt. You may be on the mountaintop today. You may be facing the enemy head on in the sword of the Spirit that God has given to you, which is the Word of God, but never be taken off guard. One moment, Elijah is standing on the mountain, confidence. God is filling him with the authority to do what God has called him to do. He led the people to repentance, to where their confession out of their mouth was, you are the one and the only true God. One chapter later, he is cowardly hiding in fear. Why? I'll tell you why. Because Elijah is running away from what God has called him to. He is running away from what God is calling him to. Look at it. It's verse 15a. The Lord said to him, go back the way that you came. That's powerful. Go back, Elijah, the way that you came. Go to the desert of Damascus. You see, here's what I need you to hear today. You will always get stuck. Always. When you are running away from what God is calling you to, you will find yourself in a dark place. You will find yourself in a cave. You will find yourself in a place where you are listening more to the enemy rather than you are listening to your God. When you are running from what God is calling you to. You see, this is my story. This is my story. When I was a junior in high school, my parents got a divorce, and it changed my life forever. And I began to take on responsibility and started to think to myself, God, if I could have just been a better son, you know, if I could have listened more to when mom and dad said something to me and not fight it, you know, if I could have been a better brother and not get in so many arguments and fights with my brothers, and if I would have done better in school. You see, what happened is I started to take on responsibility that wasn't mine to take on. and it weighed me down. And I literally believed that if somehow, in some way, I could somehow get my parents back together, that it would all work out. And I took all the blame right here. And one of the reasons that I moved so far away to college, not the reason, not the main reason, but one of the reasons why I moved to North Texas is because I was running away from the hurt and the pain and the brokenness that was in my life. I was also running away from commitment and responsibility. I dated a girl for 4 years in high school, and at the end of our senior year, she wanted to have conversation about getting married, and I said, heck no, no way. I'm not ready for that. Commitment, responsibility, not for me. What did I do? Part of the reason why I went to North Texas was to run away from what God was calling me to. Another time in my life, I found myself hurt by the church. I was beginning to share some very confidential things with a pastor, a trusted pastor. And a long story short, that pastor betrayed my confidence. And I will never forget the hurt that caused. And I said, if I can be blunt, the heck with the church. I want nothing to do with the church ever, ever again. And over time, over years, my heart started to harden. And I was bitter. I was hurt. I was wounded. And the fact that I'm here today serving as a pastor, an under-shepherd to the chief shepherd, is an absolute miracle in my life. Why? Because I was running for 15 years from what God was calling me to. I was like a Jonah in the belly of a whale, and God spit me out and said, all right, the word of the Lord comes to you, Brian, a second time, and that is grace. I'm only here because God has called me here. I didn't sign up for this. And when you are running away from what God is calling you to, you will always get stuck. Always get stuck. It is a miracle that I am here. But listen to what God says to Elijah. He gives him very clear instructions. This is verse 15. Check it out. He's so clear with what he wants him to do. And he says in verse 15, the Lord said to him, here it is, go back the way that you came. In other words, stop running from what I'm calling you to and go to the desert of Damascus. And when you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel. And anoint Elijah, son of Shaphat from Abel-Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. And jump down to verse 18. You remember Elijah felt alone. He said, I'm the only one left, but listen to what God said in verse 18. Yet I reserve, here it is, 7,000 in Israel. When you feel alone, like you're the only one left, be reminded that God is working in ways in which you do not understand, and he will always provide a remnant. Yet I reserve, God said, 7,000 in Israel, whose knees have not bowed down to Baal, and whose mouths have not kissed them. You see, when life brings you to a stop, God's calling gives you a go. When life brings you to a halt, maybe it's a sickness, maybe it's an illness, maybe it's depression, maybe it's worry, maybe it's your job, maybe it's your kids, your grandkids, maybe it's a circumstance that's been nagging you day in and day out, when it seems like there's nothing left that you have to give. When life says, here's a stop, here's a halt, God's calling is giving you a go. And this is the thing I want you to see. Elijah still had work to do. He still had anointing to give, blessing to give. He was still called by God to bring in the next generation, Elisha the prophet, to succeed him as prophet. He still had work to do. And I want to say to someone here, you have counted yourself out. You have said, I'm too old. Someone else is going to have to step up now. I can't do it anymore. I don't feel well enough. Well, I've got a word for you today. God still has something for you to do. God still is raising up leaders. The future of our church is contingent upon the leaders that we lay hands on, our youth and our children that we bless, and we say, mighty son of God, mighty daughter of God, you have a call on your life, and you are our church. You aren't the future of our church. You are our church. That is the calling that I believe we are carrying in this season of life. God is not done with you yet. Do you believe it, church? Say amen. Amen. If you think that you're done, you're not. God has a calling over your life. And I get it. The median age of our church is 65 years old. I get it. I understand. But there are more people to bless. There is a younger generation that's being called by God. There are youth that are really willing and able to serve in whatever possible way they can. God's anointing is falling fresh in ways that we've never seen before, and we are the church. Amen? Amen. And that is the direction that we are heading. But don't miss this. Don't miss this. There is a warning. There is a warning in our text, because God was specific to Elijah of what he was to do. Look at it. He was to anoint Hazael king over Aram, which he did not do. Who did it? Elisha. In 2 Kings chapter 8. He was to anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, which he did not do. Elisha did in 2 Kings chapter 9. And following these verses, starting in verse 19, Elisha received the mantle of Elijah. One out of three. The 33%. That's failing. That's disobedience. What am I saying? Don't let fear hold you captive and lead you to disobey God. Don't let your fear, don't let the voice of your enemy sound any louder than what it's worth. He's already defeated. We started our worship service today not fighting for victory, but fighting from victory. You already have the victory. Silence the enemy's voice. God's voice is power. God's strength is power. God's anointing is powerful. And what the enemy says, even though he roars around like a lion, looking for anyone who he can devour, God's power is greater because you, my friend, are a son and a daughter of the Most High God. And God has you in sight. He sees you in your struggle. He sees you in your perplexity. He is with you in the storm. He doesn't just camp out on the side. No, he gets in the mess with you. And today I want to encourage someone who's living a life that's bound in fear. All the things that are uncertain. Maybe you've lost a job and you're really struggling financially, or maybe it's your health, or maybe the health of a loved one. And you find your place in the very core of your heart discouraged. And if you would be honest with yourself, there's more listening going on to the fears of the doctor's report, of what could happen, of what may happen, then you are listening to your God's promise. Oh, I'm with you. I'm for you. I love you. I'm the great physician. I'm the healer. Though healing may not come on this side of heaven, my name is Jehovah Rapha. And one day when I call you heavenward to be with me forever, you will be completely healed. Do you trust that your Heavenly Father is a good, good God? He loves you. And today he's saying to you, I'm not done with you yet. You know, we cancel ourselves out. But isn't that a good place to be? Talk about cancel culture. Cancel culture right here. God, I am nothing. I cancel this out altogether, because isn't that where God wants us? Cancel out the flesh. Because that leads you right here. Right on your knees. Where you have no place else to turn, nowhere else to go. But when you say, God, I'm done with me. I want what you want for my life. I want your plans to unfold. I want your anointing in my life. God, I want your touch over me, over my family, over my kids, over my grandkids. How many's receiving this today? I believe it's for somebody. God is not done with you yet. He's only starting. There's a generation to come. There's a generation that's coming. The harvest is plentiful. But the workers are few. You want to see God move? Offer your hands. Say, God, here I am. Here's my life. Would you take it? I'm done with me because I know you're not done with me yet. You have a bright future for me. And I believe it today. Would you stand to your feet? We're going to pray together. I believe God wants to speak to you in a very powerful, intimate way. And maybe you're here today, or maybe you're tuning in online right now. And if you would be honest with yourself, honest with yourself, you would say, I'm stuck. I've been trying to get out of this muddy hole for so many years. But God, I'm not going to pretend like I'm not stuck anymore. I am stuck. I need you. That's the only way to get out of the mess that you are in. Maybe it's fear that's holding you back, holding you captive, leading you to disobey your God. Or maybe like Elijah, it almost feels as if your life has come to an end. You have no purpose anymore. Sickness, financial difficulty, maybe your marriage looks like it's ending and there is no hope. Maybe issues at work and frustration with the always changing dynamics of our political world. Or maybe you're even listening to the threats of the enemy today. And God says to you, I am not done with you yet. I'm still working in ways that you don't understand. So stop trying to be God. Stop trying to figure it out. Trust in my sovereign grace. Surrender to my perfect will. God, that's where we are today. I pray for your people who are gathered here, who are gathered online. I pray, God, that those who are stuck would raise their hands and say, God, I surrender. And if that's you, I invite you to put your hands out as a posture of surrender and say, Jesus, I'm no longer going to try to take control of my life, of this situation, of that problem, of that struggle. God, I don't want fear to hold me in disobedience to you. But God, free me today by the power of your Holy Spirit. Would you free me today? God, you are already victorious. And God, because you have won the day on the cross, I believe in faith that I am not living my life for the victory. I am living my life from the victory in Jesus' name. If you receive that today, say amen. 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 Amen.